We'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Maria. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. So you are here watching the first part of a series on restorative justice and sexual violence. So the first part today, we're going to be talking about understanding where we've come from, specifically looking at the sexual violence movement, and then where we can go. So moving towards a restorative justice framework. Go ahead, Maria.
Welcome. Thanks, Jenna. I am Sarah Silvas-Bernstein. I use she, her, and I am a CCASA board member. I'm also a former Title IX coordinator. So Laura, I see you in the chat box where I integrated restorative practices and justice into Naropa University. And then currently, I am a power and equity consciousness and restorative practices trainer and facilitator with my organization, Restorative Integration, with Amanda Aguilera.
And I'm Jenna Harper. I use she and her pronouns. I'm the Sexual Assault Response Program Manager here at CCASA, Colorado Coalition Against Sexual Assault.
So today, where we plan on heading to on our journey together includes a discussion about the roots of advocacy within our field and where we came from, the status quo of sexual violence advocacy, challenges in advocacy, what is missing in addressing sexual violence, what shifts are necessary, and what do we need to do to start moving towards those changes? And again, as Jenna was saying, this is the beginning of a series. And so today we're really kind of taking a pause to reflect on these topics and to have some discussions about where we've been and where we can head. And then know that in future discussions, we'll also be expanding on some of these topics and talking about more of the kind of nitty gritty on like the how to. But today is the opportunity for us to unearth some of our values, beliefs, and ideals that influence where we've been, and maybe thinking about how some of those can shift to see where we can go.
So we want to start by asking you, when you hear the words restorative justice, what words come to mind? So please go ahead, you can use the chat. Just type whatever first comes to mind when I say the word restorative justice. You can also feel free to use annotate if that's something that you're excited about. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and read what I'm seeing in the chat. Shelby wrote healing and accountability, reparations, accountability, repairing the harm, making things almost whole again, healing, repairing, healing, accountability, mutual healing, sometimes forgiveness, collective healing, absolutely. All right, community, absolutely. Righting the wrong, mm-hmm. All right, so I think all of these humanity-centered, potentially transformative, hopefully working towards transformation, absolutely. So I want us to take some of these terms and I want to point them towards, rather than the harm of sexual violence, I want to point them towards us. In the field of sexual violence. So that's where we're going to start, looking at us as a community, what type of repair we need to do within ourselves, what type of healing we need to be doing as a community, what type of accountability we need to be taking as a community, so that we can ultimately transform ourselves and work toward doing restorative justice work. Go ahead, Maria. I want to start by acknowledging that restorative justice practices and frameworks come from Indigenous roots. And, you know, when Sarah and I were talking about developing the series, we really wanted to take a big step back because people are very anxious to have practices and have more options for survivors in their community and healing. And that's, it's important. We want to be able to support people in providing that. And what we want to do is support people in doing this in the right way. And part of what that means is recognizing and really respecting the place where this comes from and the theories and frameworks behind it. And that really starts with us looking internally within ourselves as individuals and within our organizations, within our community, and within our field. Go ahead, Maria.
I'll also share on that too, that as we consider implementing practices that have different roots than capitalistic patriarchy models of economy and ways of living, that it can be a really slippery slope to implementing restorative practices and restorative justice within oppressive frameworks with good intentions. So today is actually about looking at the framework as a whole and looking at restorative justice as an element of restorative practices and a restorative community, so that we don't take restorative justice as a plug and play model and put it into an oppressive structure and try to make that fit and further harm caused. So that's another reason why this conversation feels really important to Jenna and I.
Thank you, Sarah. Absolutely. And I think we're gonna enter into a challenging conversation along those lines as to how our field and how all of us as human beings living in a capitalistic world of the United States play a part in that, and how we need to figure out how to kind of find a separation with some of these elements to be able to do restorative justice work. So that's why we're talking about, in order to move towards doing restorative justice, we need to look at where we've come from in the field. You can go to the next one. Thank you. So let's take a little bit of a look at history. And I know that there are a mix of folks here from different backgrounds. I'm assuming some of you have some sort of link to sexual violence. So when we look at the field of sexual violence or women's rights or violence against women, I want us to take a little bit of a history lesson in where we came from. And first, that's grassroots. That's women who provided peer support for women who were experiencing domestic and sexual violence. There wasn't a nonprofit structure necessarily. Well, there wasn't. There wasn't funding from the government at first. And I also want to recognize in talking about the women's rights movement and women doing this for women, all people of all gender identities do experience sexual violence. We call it the women's movement because women experience it at higher rates. That being said, plenty of people with marginalized identities other than women also experience it at higher rates too, including trans women of color, people who are non-binary, people with disabilities, et cetera. So we started off in a very grassroots place, and that shifted. It shifted because we wanted to get some legitimacy. We wanted to get some support. We wanted to get some funding. And so in 1994, VAWA was passed, and there are various options of where VAWA, which stands for Violence Against Women Act, which is the funding that provides money to sexual assault, domestic violence, community-based agencies, as well as some other efforts for addressing sexual violence and domestic violence. The choice was made to house that under Department of Justice rather than Department of Human Services or other options. So slowly from the 70s to the 90s, there was a pretty big shift from grassroots movement to professionalization and grant funding. And the what this did is it took a lot of autonomy and power away from the people who had originally been doing this work. So with funding came restrictions of who you can work with, how you could work with them with reporting, and requirements for who you had to partner with. So a large chunk of funding, BAWA funding, it's under Department of Corrections, so it goes to law enforcement. It goes to district attorney's office. It goes to corrections. It goes to different places where it is system-based rather than community-based. So that's another big one of the shifts. And a lot of the funding requirements have community-based agencies coupling with system-based folks. There's also professionalization, which I think eliminated some of the peer-based elements of the grassroots movement. So for example, having background checks required for employees meant that people who might have criminal history can no longer provide that peer-based support, even though they understand the experience of domestic and sexual violence. You can move forward. Maria. So I want to recognize that our work is hard. Doing work in the field of sexual violence is challenging. It's not well paid. We sustain a large amount of vicarious trauma, hearing stories, working within systems that can be re-traumatizing and challenging. And so burnout happens, turnover happens. Within funding, there's a lot of competition, and rather than us kind of coming together to fight together, oftentimes what that can do is instead lead to competition and to siloing. So we don't actually work together. We don't actually collaborate that much to address sexual violence. All the community-based sexual assault advocacy agencies, oftentimes we're kind of doing our own things, and that makes sense because communities can differ, and instead it can put us in competition with each other. And we also oftentimes have low capacity because of the burnout, because of the vicarious trauma, because of the competition. It feels like we don't have space to get creative. You can move forward. Yeah. And so it can be hard to be intentional. And I think that's part of why we wanted to hold this space for folks. We want to be very intentional when we're talking about starting restorative justice work or exploring restorative justice work. It's important for us to question why we're doing the work that we're doing and how we're doing the work that we're doing. I've been in this field for 17 years now, and it took me a very long time to take that step back for me to look and explore where this field, where our movements have come from, and to also take accountability for some of the missteps that we make. One of the things that I really appreciate about the restorative justice framework is that it recognizes that all of us as human beings are people who are capable of doing good and capable of doing harm. None of us are martyrs who are saviors and do good, right? We do good, but that's not the framework that we could work within. We screw up sometimes. Sometimes we hurt people. That's what it means to be a human. And that's going to be true for our movement as well. And so I think it's important to kind of take this step back and look at where we have taken some missteps and where we've neglected our communities and the work that can be done, that it needs to be done, and to think creatively. And again, you know, I'm just thinking back to somebody who said in one of our monthly restorative justice calls, like, one of the reasons we're not doing restorative justice work is because the capacity to think creatively is diminished when you are so burnt out and the work is so hard. So really want to recognize and appreciate that. You could go for it, Maria. So I want to ask you this question. How is sexual violence connected to oppression and harms within our communities? So sexual violence and oppression and other harms, other things that harm our communities. How are those things connected? I recognize this is a very big question. And so please feel free to take a minute before you type this into the chat. And I also do wanna set an expectation that in a couple slides, we're gonna put you in breakout rooms. So you're gonna have time to process this and a couple other questions, and then you'll have the opportunity to chat with other folks about the questions that we've posed to you.
There was a chat entry that says that narratives pass down. And I'm wondering if you'd be willing to speak more to that. And if not, that's totally fine. But I really am curious to hear more about the idea of narratives passing down.
Isms that are passed down.
Yeah, great. Can you hear me? I can totally speak to that. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, just larger systems of narratives that are passed down for generations with different ideas of what other people need to be or what other people are based on our own personal identities and social locations and not based on the reality of the person that we're relating to. So coming from those bigger systems and how those bigger systems still inform the way we relate to other people.
Absolutely.
Ooh, Jennifer and Ben were caught kissing.
I was just gonna reflect on what you were just saying about kind of stories and isms passing down. And this reminded me of Aurora Levins Morales's work, an article she wrote called The Historian as Curandera. And this piece talks about history and like how we look upon kind of these stories that you're talking about and the narratives that pass down, looking at what else needs to be told, what other stories and dynamics of humans and their wholeness need to be brought to the surface as almost like a healing salve for history. And so when I hear you talk about narratives and isms, I'm hearing like a call in those areas for this like healing salve of understanding humanness as dynamic, like Jenna was talking about before, that there can be complexity of oppressor and oppressed, and people hold many different intersections of not only identities, but characteristics and personalities. And can we look beyond the isms and the stories that are unhelpful?
I'm also seeing in the chat that sexual violence is usually about power. When power has been taken in other ways, how else can one get it back? Sexual violence is pretty access, is pretty easy access for that reclaiming. Okay, Rebecca wrote, sexual violence is a tool used to perpetrate racism, colonialism, classism, ableism, cisgenderism, heterosexism, all the isms. Okay. Yes, so a lot of the isms, all forms of oppression are connected to sexual violence. Power is connected to sexual violence at its base, whether or not somebody is recognizing their actions when they're sexually harming somebody as entrenched in that and being a cognizant choice, the way that we have grown up in this society with biases. I think that that plays a role in all that we do, and it absolutely is used as a tool as well. And I also want us to think, you know, we'll keep moving, but I also just want us to keep in mind the other half of that question, other harms within our community. That sexual violence is connected to oppression, and oppression is connected to many other harms. So then how is sexual violence connected to other harms in our community? And what other partnerships might we need in our community? What other relationships, what might we need in our community to be addressing those harms? How might we need to look at a comprehensive framework of harm that encapsulates oppression and sexual violence and healing and restoration and transformation? All right, let's go ahead and move forward, Maria.
Lori also had posted a really great question into the chat. And one thing that question of what does it mean when the formal legal response to sexual violence also perpetuates the isms? When I hear that question, I'm also reminded that often this work can bring up more questions than answers when we start digging in. So thank you for bringing that question up. And there's kind of a twist on that question that I'll get to later in the presentation, but I really encourage questions. Like maybe you don't have an answer to one of our questions, maybe you have a question to a question, and that's really juicy too. So thank you for sharing that.
Yes, and I think that question also goes back to like the way that we are addressing sexual violence and addressing healing and addressing harm in our society. We wanted this to be an opportunity for ourselves to reflect how we're doing that and how that takes into account the larger picture of oppression. So I think that question gets to that. So to follow that up, many of us who work for sexual assault agencies or dual sexual assault domestic violence agencies or a program whose mission is to address sexual violence, we have in our mission statements, working to end sexual violence, in quotes. What are we doing to end sexual violence? Not to address sexual violence, but what work are we doing right now in our programs, in our services, in our individual actions within our community, in the work that we do to work towards ending it, making so that sexual violence doesn't exist in our communities.
Yeah, please feel free to share in the chat or speak into this space if it feels, if you feel called to.
And also, if you would like to wait until you get to your small groups to do that as well, sitting with silence can also be healthy. So we'll give it a minute. All right, let's go ahead and move forward. We'll give folks the opportunity to discuss this more in their groups. Okay, Laura wrote educating people on harms of sexual violence causes. Mm-hmm. Within our communities, within individuals, how does sexual violence harm? Yeah, talking about it. Shelby wrote education and attention. Insisting on having these conversations, these difficult conversations, and early education to empower and build safety nets is important, so important. Advocates in our county join with school systems to do this. Mm-hmm. Advocates for dialogues create, allocate resources. Mm-hmm. Working with the middle and high school students and teaching a violence prevention curriculum, including boundary setting and practicing consent. Absolutely. Yeah, thank you for sharing all that. Embodying and normalizing consent to our babies. Yes, prevention starts at the earliest of ages and is something that can exist at every single level of our beings.
And one thing I want to mention, and we'll see shortly in the presentation, different behaviors that we can take on within this structure of sexual violence, advocacy, and education are behaviors that are reactive, responsive, and proactive. And what I'm noticing in all of these chat responses, when the question is geared towards ending sexual violence, all of these are really proactive measures, and those actually really line up with restorative practices as a framework. So I think that I wanted to point that out, because when we get to that slide, I think it's a little bit of an aha that education and community building and relationship building and maintenance are so essential. And I can point to those of you who have already responded to say, oh, here are some ways that you're doing that. So thank you.
Yeah, and I also want to point, Rebecca said working on housing access for survivors, new ways of imagining housing and home. And I think that this goes back to the idea, you know, I think with domestic violence, especially the idea of housing is very much a service that's provided. But thinking of housing, thinking of substance use, thinking of other, like houselessness, the other harms that our communities experience and how those are also tied to sexual violence. Okay, so this is another really big, broad question, but what does liberation mean?
And sometimes when I think about big questions like this, I think about like components of it too, like maybe not having, if I can't think of a full answer, I think of, you know, what are some elements of it? So, you know, another way to think about this could be, what are some components or elements of liberation to you and your understanding of it?
Absolutely. So liberation, Laura's saying, is being free from sexual violence. Mm-hmm. It's having choices, absolutely. It's freedom. It's freeing. It's individual and collective autonomy. Mm-hmm. Liberation for us as communities. Okay, let's go ahead and move forward, Maria, so that we can give folks a good chance to chat about this within their breakout groups. So we want you to spend some time in some small groups to talk about what it means to work towards liberation. What does liberation mean? You might want to spend some time talking about too. But what would it mean for the work that you do to move from a menu of services to working towards liberation, to working towards transformation? Within the context of sexual violence, within that work. So we're gonna leave it broad, because I feel like there's been a lot of like big questions posed, and we believe that you can have some great conversations with that. So Maria just put the questions in the chat, and she's going to go ahead and divide you up into groups. We'll have you there for about 10 minutes, and then we will come back and we will debrief. Thanks, welcome back. So we would love to hear from some folks what you chatted about in your groups, if you would like to share. So go ahead, if you're able to turn your video on, go ahead and turn your video on, or go ahead and unmute yourself. If you wanna like put a hand up, if you're interested, either a physical hand in your video, or if you want to do raise your hand on Zoom, and talk about what you talked about. And Maria did just put in the chat a reminder that your video will not be recorded. So who would like to share about something that they discussed in their groups? Thanks, Graham.
Yeah, no problem. So yeah, we got pretty overwhelmed in our conversation because it is just so massive a concept to try and wrap our heads around. Recognizing the intersectionality between all these different forces that are causing harm based on, you know, systems that have been set up deliberately to advantage affluent white men by oppressing all other identities have been deeply rooted and entrenched in our society. So looking at the wealth disparity, the education disparity, the different ways that different identities are treated along lines of race or gender identity, all of these things are a confluence of circumstances that set up conditions for sexual violence. So until we look at, you know, all of these forces that influence housing and poverty and all these other things that leave people vulnerable to violence, it's hard to just keep this issue in a silo. And really that's kind of where we came to the conclusion was we need to find a way to educate the mass populace about, you know, the systems that we live in order to have a baseline to work from. And then we can give them skills such as, you know, intervention strategies and a sense of responsibility for public safety that every single citizen should have. So if we can raise the awareness, give people the knowledge through education, and then give them some skills to participate in making conditions safer for everybody, that was the best we had.
Yeah, thank you. Well, that was a lot. Yes, absolutely. Recognizing oppression and how it functions in our society is foundational. It's foundational to the work that we do, and seeing how that's connected to people who cause sexual harm, people who experience sexual harm, and the way that our community deals with it, and then how we can help support people to develop skills and to learn how to address it. Absolutely. Thank you, Graham. I wonder what other folks, anyone talk about what liberation would mean in the context of your work? Did anyone talk about the history of the movement or the field or the organization that you came from? Anyone work on building relationships, getting to know each other?
I can go. I think we talked about in ours, like, just the biggest part is like serving the person in front of you and then later making that work fit whatever boxes you need to check. But like, really, like, I feel like coming from where I have been, the biggest success I have seen has been moving away from like this, I guess, menu of services boxes, any of that sort of stuff, and really seeing what it is that the person in front of me wants and what that looks like and how to free them from just the ideas of that it has to be like what it has been or what something should be or somebody else's definition of that, and just doing what they ask and offering them the choices to freely choose how they want their own liberation and transformation to look like. And then also talking to them about like, what is it that you want? How do you want this resolved with the other party or their family or what this looks like within community? How do you need my help advocating for you within your own community on what those further things look like? And it doesn't have to be like each person gets their own vision. And I think sometimes within systems, that's really hard to accomplish because we like everything to be dressed up pretty and some uniformity and that everybody's getting certain things. And yet when we do that, we take away the ability for people to access things they actually need. So I think it's, you know, allowing that freedom of choice and options that might not normally be there.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate you talking about, like, there's a menu of limited options that I think many people who work in advocacy are used to. And sometimes because we're used to having such limited choices, we don't have the opportunity, and because of the other constraints we talked about, we don't always sit and authentically ask, what do you really need? What do you see as healing? Like, what do you see as your needs? And what do you really want? And allowing them to go wherever they go and considering what that could be and how we could support them in that. And so I think that I appreciate you saying that, Jamie. Okay. Iris said, a part of liberation is giving the person realistic choices. Post-data education, relationship building is a huge part of trauma recovery, including sexual violence. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I think, like, what are options right now for survivors? And how can we help to expand those options? How can we work to expand those options to look more towards liberation, to look more towards community, to look more towards relationships, healing? Beyond what we list on our website. These are big questions, I recognize. And feel free to share, it doesn't have to be in response to what I was asking, but share whatever came up in your groups. Maybe we'll take one more person and then move on. All right, for me, every option is on the table. I say that, what does possibility look like? I let them shoot for the moon, we figure it out. All right. So we had our last person speak. Let's move on, Sarah.
Great. Okay, and Amy also just mentioned, we talked about the importance of education about consent. Yes, again, one of those proactive measures that I was talking about earlier. Thank you for sharing that. So as we bridge this idea of moving from service delivery to liberation, I have heard quite a few shares already in the chat or verbally that are moving us toward that direction. So unsiloing from service, checking service boxes towards what's like the shoot for the moon, as was shared in the chat box. What are those possibilities for harm repair and for harm prevention? I also heard the importance of both intrapersonal relationships within organizations and then interpersonal relationships across organizations and across community and other advocacy and service providing agencies. So we're getting closer in what we're already sharing, moving from service provision to liberation. And then going back to that kind of question to a question that Lori asked, I come back to this other question from one of my favorite liberation education facilitators, Andrea Renee. On the right side of the slide here, she asks, how do we get to a way of being with each other that does not impose oppressive restrictions on our humanity? And that question really helps me start to think about and conceptualize what liberation can be within the framework of sexual violence prevention. and also sexual violence, addressing it as well. And when I think about how do we get to a way of being with others that does not impose oppressive restrictions on humanity, I start to think about frameworks of restorative practices. And so you've probably noticed that I am using the language restorative practices and the verbiage restorative justice. And so I want to take a moment to situate restorative justice within the framework of restorative practices. And restorative practices, I even like to situate that wider into a framework of restorative community. And so today, like I shared at the very beginning of our time together, we're hoping that instead of trying to jump right into providing restorative justice in your community without the frameworks of restorative practices or restorative community, that we take that pause, like Jenna was inviting us to do at the beginning, to take the pause to think creatively, to shift possibly paradigms around the structures that within we employ restorative justice, so that we also are willing to do the work that we are asking those who we provide services to do. So I really like this quote here that's calls for restorative practices are those that are processes that proactively build healthy relationships and a sense of community to prevent and address conflict and wrongdoing. So I highlighted some specific words in this quote because they're really important to where we're going when we conceptualize restorative justice as an element of restorative practices and restorative community. And why I am situating restorative justice within a larger framework is so that we can avoid kind of that plug and play model where maybe we take a punitive measure out and just substitute it for restorative justice without actually looking at the larger framework that we are using restorative justice within. So here we're seeing in this quote that proactively building healthy relationships is so important. And that is really what we're focusing on today. And in another slide, I'll really kind of show you why it's so important as the foundation to restorative practices as a whole. And so many of you have already talked about how you proactively build healthy relationships, and you'll have more of an opportunity to share in breakout groups around how you're doing this later. And I'm also really excited to talk about how we're proactively building healthy relationships intrapersonally with ourselves, because if we think back to what Jenna was talking about earlier, the necessity for this pause, the necessity for thinking creatively is coming because of widespread burnout and scarcity mindset and the inability to offer more than the checklist of services on a more regular basis than we might want to. So we're going to talk about not only building healthy relationships in our communities, like so many of you have already added into this conversation, but also proactively building healthy relationships within ourselves. And once we build those healthy relationships, then we can start thinking about preventing and addressing conflict. But within a model of restorative practices, we don't just prevent and address conflict in a silo. We have to think about first building the relationship. So then when and if we have to prevent and address conflict and wrongdoing, the relationships are already there. So this is really essential that we think about building healthy relationships with ourselves and others. Next slide. So the first thing I want to talk about as we move into kind of bridging service provision to liberation is I want to talk about the social discipline window. And I really like this quote here on the left side of the screen. Human beings are happier, more cooperative and productive, and more likely to make positive changes in their behavior when those in positions of authority do things with them rather than to them or for them. And so if we look over to the right side of the screen, let's take a peek at the social discipline window. So some of you might be intimately familiar with this window, but for those of you who aren't, it's always good to revisit. Let's talk about it a little bit. So this window describes four basic approaches to addressing behavior that needs to be changed. The four strategies are represented as different combinations of high or low control and high or low support. And you can see in that upper right quadrant, the restorative domain combines high expectations of behavior and high support and is characterized by doing things with people rather than to them or for them. So this restorative approach allows us to address harms while also practicing empathy and maintaining a strong relationship. One of the most common rebuttals that I have heard when working with organizations to implement a restorative practices framework into their community is, well, restorative feels like we are just gonna let people do whatever. And that actually is that permissive quadrant where there's just a lot of support, but really no control or responsibility. And that's not what we're talking about. So if that maybe has been you, or if you have heard that rebuttal from someone that restorative approaches are really just kind of a lackadaisical way of addressing harms, remind folks that there is this element of both high support and high responsibility, or control is another word that's been used in this model. I like the word responsibility. So high support, high responsibility, both of those are present with the restorative model. And also what really strikes me about the restorative strategy for addressing behavior is the humility it requires on the part of the teacher, facilitator, parent, or other person that has a position of status or role power. So rather than that person in a position of power thinking that what they know is best and approaching the problem with an already formed answer, which is often the case with punitive and permissive strategies, the restorative strategy approaches the issue by asking questions and with a humble and compassionate desire to better understand. And this really goes back to that chat that was posted by Jamie and Megan, where every option's on the table. Let's look at all possibilities. Let's shoot for the moon and figure it out versus coming to the table and saying checkbox 1, 2, or 3. This is how we can support you. This is really looking at having that dialogue, that conversation that Jamie and Megan had put into the chat. So take a moment, and I'm not necessarily going to be asking for a whole lot of feedback on this one because we'll move to the next slide, but this is the question that I'm going to ask is for you to consider. Which strategy in the social discipline window might be your default response or your organization's default response? And it might be different based on your relationship. So it might be very different based on your like intimate or spousal relationship than it is in service provision at your place of employment or where you do your primary work in the world. Think about which strategy within this window is your default response. Are you prone to avoiding conflict and maybe not doing anything to address harm? Do you maybe jump straight to punitive or punishment-like measures? Do you maybe make excuses or accept excuses on a regular basis for harmful behavior? Knowing these things about yourself and or your organization will help you know which direction you can grow towards a restorative approach. So as you assess, what's my default response? Am I high on control, low on control, high on support, low on support? Am I finding a way to blend support and responsibility? As you are able to identify your own responses about you and your organization to how your default response is within the social discipline window, you can maybe start to remind yourself, oh, I know that it's helpful for me to remember that I need to hold higher expectations of behavior, or that I might need to remember to take a step back from only being in control and show more support. So that's what this window can help us provide a peek into. Let's go ahead and move to the next slide. So as I think about working with a community, working with someone who is seeking support services, or working with someone who may have caused harm, the following, I'm gonna share with you six principles that I, within my organization, Restorative Integration, used to approach employing a restorative framework. So first, I like to utilize available, appropriate, creative, and flexible resolution methods. And this provides a spectrum of options to empower participants as co-creators of conflict resolution. Like, I really feel like this is a theme that's coming up quite a bit today around creative, flexible resolution methods. The next was building and restoring people and communities involved in and affected by harm and conflict. And then the next is focusing on healing, repair, and accountability rather than punishment. And again, if we're just focusing on punishment, we're just hanging out in that upper left quadrant of punitive measures. We're doing things to someone, and that's not helpful. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So attentiveness to conflict is something that is actually about skill building, and it's a learning opportunity for all involved. The next principle that I think about when I consider restorative practices is that conflict is seen as a symptom of community dysfunction, and healing needs to be a community effort. So looking at not necessarily what rule was violated, but who was harmed, how were they harmed, and how can we address those harms? And then finally, I believe that a restorative framework reframes conflict from a dualistic and competitive situation to an inclusive and collaborative one that recognizes the humanity in all parties. And recognizing the humanity in all parties really helps lead us towards the liberatory model, while also embracing what Jenna was talking about earlier, where individuals can possess a multitude of identities and characteristics that a perpetrator also likely can have experienced harm and sexual violence in their past as well. So when we can reframe conflict from a dualistic scenario to one that's inclusive and collaborative, we start to really recognize the humanity in all parties involved in harm that's caused. Let's move to the next slide. So here I want to share with you the restorative practices pyramid. And again, right now we're situating restorative justice within a larger framework, again, to slow us down and to maybe have us pause before we go right to, you know, I went to this restorative justice webinar and I want to start doing restorative justice within my community. Slowing that down and thinking about, oh, wait, there's actually some building blocks before we even get to repairing harm. What do we need to do to actually build relationships and maintain relationships within our communities first and as primary steps? So here within the restorative practices pyramid, we can see that relationship building is really the foundation of restorative practices. This is where some activities such as connection circles, collective care, trust building are essential. We'll talk more about these momentarily. And once we've built relationships, then we get to move to maintaining relationships. So this is where communication is essential, where we learn about impact statements, where we can give and receive feedback, where we can start to conceptualize conflict through positive lenses and seeing conflict as opportunities for investment in relationship rather than conflict as a way to deflect or to come up with dualistic paradigms of who's right and wrong in this situation. And then once we've built and maintained relationships, inevitably within interpersonal interactions, conflict will occur. We do, once we're in relationship, we have differing needs, beliefs, expectations, and desires than someone else. And often when those can clash, and when those clash, that's when we can think about repair. And so I know when I first started to think about implementing restorative justice within Naropa University, I shared at the beginning, that's one place that I had implemented it. I thought about restorative justice kind of alone as kind of this plug and play. We're gonna stop doing this model and we're gonna start doing this other model because it kind of felt like quote unquote maybe sexy to me. Like this is the new thing. And what I learned was that there's actually a lot of slowing down to create a new paradigm within an entire organization, institution, and or community to get to the place of sitting down in a circle for repair, that relationship building and relationship maintenance is actually really essential to doing this work. So let's go to the next slide. So I want to ask, you know, where are your organization's efforts spent? And we can take that triangle and we can put it right and overlay it right over this arrow here. And reactive responses are really kind of that top tier. That's when, you know, conflict happens and harm needs to be addressed. Then we have responsive behaviors, and these are those maintenance communicative behaviors, and that middle tier about maintaining relationships. And then we have these proactive relationships, and that's at the very bottom of the base of the triangle. This is about building relationship behaviors. And today I've heard a lot of responses to that question of, you know, what are you doing to end sexual assault, matching up with the proactive area of this arrow, but really, where are your organization's efforts most spent? And again, this is just a reflection question for the moment, but if you're hanging out in that reactive space extensively, how might it be impacting burnout? How might it be impacting punitive or permissive approaches to harmful behaviors? Or how might it be impacting your organization's work towards liberation? So where are your organizations hanging out, and how can that share with you some information on moving towards a restorative model, which primarily focuses on these proactive building relationship approaches? Go to the next slide. So maybe just some quick chat responses. When you think about restorative justice as a practice situated within a larger framework of restorative practices, what comes up for you? Is this something that you're familiar with? Is this new to you? Help us kind of take a temperature for the group that's present here and let us know about what comes up for you when you think of RJ situated within a larger paradigm of RP or restorative practices. And you can also share aloud if that feels better than the chat for you too. And this could be the first time that you're conceptualizing RRJ as a component of restorative practices. And it might just, you know, take some time to digest and think about that and what that means for you and your organization. So I invite you to continue to reflect on that question and how, you know, how you're connecting RJ within a larger framework. And let's move on. And I'll just put the next slide up and you can again take a peek here as you are thinking through RJ as a component of RP, what this looks like. So if we're focusing on relationship building today, and again, in the future, we're going to be focusing on other elements of this triangle, such as relationship maintenance and relationship repair. But today, if we're focusing on relationship building, let's talk briefly about relationship building with self and community. Let's go to the next slide. So I have been framing a lot of my conceptualizations of building relationship with self within advocacy and service provision work within the framework of Adrian Marie Brown and the work of the NAT ministry. And I really enjoy this quote from Adrian Marie Brown: pleasure activism are the actions that we take to reclaim our happiness, joy, and the possibility of contentment from the weight of oppression and the myths of supremacy. So thinking about building relationship with self as an essential component of restorative practices, why might focusing on the relationship with yourself, such as your well-being, be essential in advocacy, justice, and liberation work? And do you have any practices of cultivating self-joy, happiness, and well-being? And what are they? Feel free to share in the chat or share aloud. I think that talking about building relationship with self is something that we don't do enough of in this kind of work. And again, I think it's also such an essential component. So please share, and you might inspire someone else on why you think it's important to be doing self-relationship building and maybe how you go about doing that. Yes, Natalie, joy is contagious. Nature and music and dancing. Yes, thank you for sharing that. Anyone else want to share how they connect this idea of pleasure activism as a way to combat the weight of oppression and myths of supremacy? Self-healing and giving grace to myself. Thank you for sharing that in the chat box. And for the sake of time, I encourage you to continue thinking about this as an essential component and not just sweeping it under the rug of like, oh, this is just another conversation about self-care. I'm really hoping for you to walk away from this conversation, framing the building of your relationship with yourself as a way to actually start doing restorative practices as a foundation to restorative justice within your work. I hear also in the chat box, I enjoy experiencing the strength and beauty in my culture and being an activist for my family and friends outside of work. Standing up for them helps me stand up for myself. Yeah. Let's talk about building relationships with community on the next slide. So building relationships with community is all about trust building and collective care. And some ways to go about doing that include creating, you know, group agreements. I am seeing more and more organizations and community spaces employing group agreements. I think that is so important. And also absolutely helps create trust within it, and especially when those group agreements are collaboratively created. Connection circles, and we will talk more about kind of the how-to of connection and solution circles in future webinars, but essentially a intentional enclosed space for community members to share on particular topics and or to share about solutions to particular challenges in a way that all voices are heard and respected and welcomed and belong within the circle. And again, these kinds of connections, solution circles, and group agreements contribute to trust building and collective care. And finally, how important it is for us to make sure that these efforts are accessible opportunities for connection and community. So if you are thinking about having some community connection time, but maybe it's like an alcohol-oriented happy hour event, well, thinking about, is that accessible for all of our community members, or are there other ways that we can incorporate like other kinds of beverages or other ideas? You know, that's just one example that I have seen community spaces start to rethink when they are bringing community members together to build relationships. Just thinking through how accessible are these opportunities for connection. And Rebecca, I really also wanted to share the comment that you brought forward for building relationships with self, and that is orgasms, especially for we adult survivors of child sexual abuse. Figuring out how to connect to the self through sexuality can be scary and also really healing. Thank you very much for sharing that. So let's pop over to the next slide. And we're not going to have time for breakouts today, but I would like to hear out just in the group, how are you already building, or how might you build relationships with intention, either with self or community? And again, conceptualizing that building relationships with self and community are essential to doing the work of restorative justice, of repairing relationships. So we don't get to repair relationships if we don't build them first. So how are you already building, or how might you go about building relationships with self or community with intention? Let's get some ideas out there so that we can end our time together on this note of inspiration. Thanks, Jenna. Jenna shared working on vulnerability with self and others. How else might folks continue or begin in a new way to build relationship with self and others as a component of restorative practices and restorative justice within your work? I think similar to Jenna, I would say for me, it's like putting this work out, sharing this work about reconceptualizing restorative justice in a way that's situated within a larger framework of restorative practices. And like having these conversations helps me build relationships with others, but also with myself, and knowing like, this is really important work to do. And it feels good for me to be able to share this with others. And that reinforces my self-relationship, which also helps me engage with others. Well, we are just at our last minute, so let's move to the last slide. And Jenna and I will hang out on the call for a minute. And so for anyone who might have, if anyone needs to jump off at this time, feel free. For others who have questions, comments, reflections, and feedback, we are here. And then some folks just popped in the chat. Some great responses to how they're building relationships that I'll name quickly. So setting up roundtable events with underserved communities to listen and learn. Great, I love that. Seeking our communities to be involved in, yes. Learning how to practice self-accountability helps me to expect accountability from other people I'm in relationship with. Rerooting, reclaiming where we come from culturally, the history, the impact in our present, our relationship to the earth, the ways we continue to self-violate in others. Yes, thank you. These are really important ways that we're building relationship with self and others. So again, we'll hang out. We've put our contact information up on the slide. And our next webinar in this series will be about power. And it will be about understanding what is power, conceptualizing power within interpersonal, systemic, and collective relationships. And you can expect to hear more about that from CCASA in the future.
Well, thank you both so much for your time this morning and sharing this awesome information. We really appreciate it for you to have spent this time with us. I also want to let folks know that any questions not answered, you can always reach out to our presenters. You can reach out to me. Look up for a follow-up email here shortly with the presenter's contact information, with a copy of the slide deck, with some links if you wanted to learn more, and then just a little bit more information about how to access the recording. And definitely a link to that survey. That's very helpful for us. Please do fill that out. We do read those and we share them with our presenters as well. We do have a couple of webinars coming up in June. One is still kind of in the works, but it's our Public Health for Public Safety, a community movement to amplify voices, shift paradigms, and promote safety, health, and healing. That was postponed from last month. And we also have someone from Valor US, formerly CalCASA, on June 23rd at 10 a.m., who's going to be presenting on using storytelling as community engagement tools for primary prevention efforts. So do keep an eye out for those. We hope to see you at those future webinars, as well as future webinars in the series. So we will stick around for a little bit longer in case you all have any additional questions, but you can always reach out to any of us for any additional information or help you might need. Thanks everyone for being here. And thanks again, Jenna and Sarah.